somebody your best. Just to feel blessed, special request to my love and your rest. Impress, I'll watch the rhythm slide. I watch the rhythm slide right up your dress. Till I can take you with me. I'm not going home. It's not over. I'm not going home till I can take you with me. I'm not going home. It's not over. I'm not going home till I can take you with me. I'm not going home. 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 It's not over. I'm not going home. It's not over. I'm not going home. 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 I'm not going
before proceeding with this show, we'll have to do one more test. Testing at maximum volume. Starting in 10.
Made to live this life, and live is what I've done. fade from my eyes. My plane could fall from the sky. The world could tell me this is my time. Count my blessings every day. I'm more than I deserve. Sing this song when I am gone. I'll be in every word. But I know the light could fade from my eyes. My plane could fall from the sky. The world could tell me this is my time. And if I should die here tonight, darling, know that you saved my life. Felt your love every day. Had a thing I would change, and I know you'll be okay. Super! Mulțumim! Wow! Cu efect aici! Da! Sper că v-ați energizat măcar un pic așa să intrăm în the festive vibes. Văd că avem un singur participant din afară, așa că o să las la atitudinea voastră dacă vreți să vorbim în engleză sau în română. Dacă sunteți ok, o să fac prima parte în engleză, pe mine nu mă deranjează, și după aia it's up to you, cum vreți să... Deci, mulțumim din nou, Gabi. Gabi, o să revină un pic mai târziu până se recalibrează în partea asta de instrumente în staff. Așa că o să trec direct la partea mea, repede 5 minute, sper să mă mișc rapid. Zac. O secundă. So welcome to our Christmas sharing special edition. So here it is, the 14th meeting of our community and the last one this year. I'm super excited to finally being here, and you know, I wasn't expecting to have so many meetups. So I'm glad that you are here, and I'm glad that we managed to come together, because most of you are people that come quite often at our meetups.
Just some rules for for our way of organizing things in the meetups. Following the global code of conduct, because as you know, we are a global movement which promotes equal rights in the community through meetings, networks, sharing sessions, workshops, but trying to build a safe and friendly meeting environment. So I encourage you to use appropriate language, to focus on arguments, to smile, and to try to learn at least something new. Of course, if you want to read all the details, just have a click here on rladies.org code of conduct. Also on our meetup page, you have seen the details. So I encourage you all the time to have this reading ahead of the first meeting. That being said, let's go fast forward. I would remind you that we are available and we are online on Twitter. And our community has the We Are Our Ladies project. I invite you to participate. We have tonight Maria. Maria was a curator this year in August. Thank you, Maria. But of course, I encourage any member to participate in this project. It's 1 week of moderation of this account. So this is quite a good opportunity for promotion, but also for networking. Then we have the Our Ladies directory with members for building opportunities for events, for conference or projects. So I encourage you to register there as well. We have at least 3 members, of which I remember now already there, but feel free to be the next one. And of course, you can participate in the Slack. We have the Slack community. Since we are here online, I can very fast show you. This is how you can enroll. You go on rladies.org, and there is right here on right here in the back, the Slack button, so you can enroll in this community as well. It's a very big community. Imagine that we are in so many countries, therefore you can find us. I think I just removed the share door.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes, you have removed the share screen.
Let me get back here. Okay. It's right here, but this button. Come on. Sorry. I don't know how to make it it appears again. Okay, that was such a bad idea. I'm terrible. Okay, let me close again the share, and I will just move on my presentation link again. Yeah, what can I say? Good, so don't forget to spread the word. And of course, to come back to our events with more friends. So tell your friends, of course. Just some lines on next year. So I'm going to, so there's going to be a break, which will be until February. We will be back on February with a new meetup. Most probably it will be on digital analytics, I think, as I discussed with Simona. Then in March, we have Julia Silge with, if you know her, it's the author of Tidy Text. She's involved in Tidy Models, packages. So this is confirmed. She will be for sure in March. So these are the plans for next year. So follow us on Meetup, on Twitter, on Facebook. We are all over. So now going back to the agenda, I hope I was on time. So the rules are really simple. It's just as we, you know, as you go in a meeting at work, in which you have 5 minutes to tell a story and 5 minutes to be asked questions or challenged. I don't know. It depends on the scope of your meeting. So the idea would be based on the Google Sheet. I will share with you the Google Sheet here in chat. Okay, so this is the agenda for tonight. Each one that is registered in the Google Sheet will have 5 minutes to present a topic he or she chose, and then 5 minutes either to extend or to have questions. So this is the plan. Now, because most of us are from Romania, I encourage you to have the presentation in English to be fair. However, if you prefer, I don't know, you had a long day or whatever, you can switch to Romanian. It's up to you. Just please announce at the beginning. Also, if there is someone not okay with us recording the event, please let me know now or later. If you don't want to appear in the video, please close your video so your face it's not seen. If this is your option. So I think these are the rules. So I said about the agenda, I said about the recording. Now let's start. So, Marius, is it okay for you to start, to be the first?
Yes.
I will give you co-host, right? So you can share and use all the tools available here. Marius prepared us a topic on Golem framework using Shiny. So repair application, as he told me. And as you remember, he's also a fan of Shiny. So this is how I remember Marius from, I think, the second meeting, community meeting in which we first met. So okay. I leave you the floor, okay. Marius.
Okay, thank you, Ines. And congratulations for Julia Silch. She's a big name in our community, a very big name. And I'm looking forward to hear her, to see her actually here in March. Thank you to Gabriel for the music. I really enjoyed it. And thank you for this meeting. It's really a good opportunity, great opportunity to share you guys my what I'm working on right now, and maybe get insights or provide you with insights about what it is that I'm working. Unfortunately, my presentation is in Romanian, but I'll just translate it. I wanted to use the RPA concept here. And well, you don't have to read necessarily the definition, because what I think is that Shiny app are basically RPA software. I mean, I'm sorry to see, especially in the R community, mostly on Twitter, this is what I follow. I mean, the global R community, that actually Shiny is not used often, or I think not at all, in conjunction with RPA. RPA is it's kind of hip in Romania right now. mostly because of web UiPath, but companies are trying to automate processes, and I find Shiny a great tool for that. So for me, Shiny, it's equal to RPA, and I really think that it should be used more often in conjunction with Shiny with RPA. Let me tell you a little bit about my context. So I use Shiny at my work. I'm a credit risk manager, and my context is this. I need to process repetitive reports. I need to store them, and I need to visualize them, download them, interact with them a little bit for an inter-department inside my department, which will mean about 10 or 20 users, it depends. So this is my need, and I believe this can be a common need for a lot of people. I mean, especially in banking sector. I'm not exactly in a bank, I'm in a national loan guarantee fund, but its activity mimics a bank. You have at the end of the month a lot of reports, a lot of processing to do, and that is a repetitive task. A repetitive task asks for a robot, as they say, and that is what where Shiny comes in. Another thing about my context is that I don't have access to a database, programmatically speaking, meaning that I cannot connect to my SQL database. And this probably, I don't know, probably it happens for some of you or it doesn't, but this is just my context. Our database administrator has not provided me rights to access SQL from within Shiny, of course. So, and another thing, the app deployment can only be made on an internal server. So no Shiny apps IO. This can be a little tricky, but not necessarily. So it's not really a constraint. It's just, I interpret it as a tool. This is the tool that I have to deploy my application, my RPA, right? So after I have started and I have developed during this year a lot of application, I have discovered that you really don't need a database engine for processing reports, for processing monthly reports or daily reports and store them. Not every apps that deal data needs a database, and you probably read a lot of articles that really go into this thing. You really shouldn't think about using a database first thing you start. You really have to analyze your context. So all my info, all my data that I'm processing is stored within within files of type R, RDA or RDS, it depends. I have not decided which is actually the best solution. Probably they all are. And an important lesson that you develop, that you learn while developing Shiny apps, and I'll talk about Shiny apps right now, is not to load all your data, and learn to be very careful with loading a lot of data, and that means you really should think about this UX US thing, the user experience. The user needs to see probably some sort of reports, and the data usually gets loaded whenever it's deleted or updated, but not loading the data unless it's absolutely necessary. And of course, I know this is obvious. In order to have a good application, the key is a good architecture. I know that this is something you'll hear everywhere, but a good architecture is really very difficult to produce, especially at the beginning of a project. It's easier said than done. That a good architecture is the key to a good project, but unless you're very experienced, it shouldn't be really a concern. I mean, I know most of my time, or an important part of my time, had been spent doing and redoing modules, process flow, because I didn't know at the beginning exactly how my app should look like. And it may seem strange for some of you. Yeah, I know exactly how my app should look like. Yeah, you probably know at the beginning when the app seems simple. But after it gets more complex, you really don't know. If you can, you should try to maybe write it on paper, or try to get a sense of your architecture. I'm warning you. Every shiny app that you try to develop for production purposes, I mean, this is really something that you need to you will use in production, even if it's only you that you'll use it, will appear very simple at first. Will appear very simple, but it gets very, very complex really, really quick. And I'm sure you hear that or you read that all the time, because this is a pattern in developing shiny app. We are using shiny app for prototyping, but when we go to production, we'll try to use something else, which really shouldn't be the case. The reason that I think this pattern appears everywhere, because I hear everywhere about that, is that in production, you will never need a simple app. Or rarely, extremely rarely, you'll need a simple app. No faithful geyser app needed in production. In production, even for some small processing of data, you still have to upload data, you have to process it, you have to provide with the download button, with some sort of interaction from user. And it really gets complex really, really, really quickly. So a complex app can only be managed with shiny modules. And for the last 2 or 3 years, I think you should hear about shiny modules. I think 2 years, not 3 years. And I have done it, and I can tell you that really a complex app cannot be developed unless you're using modules. And the main reason that I found for that is that you're working on a big app that has let's say you don't use module, and you try to add something or you try to modify something. If you don't use modules, you'll, in case you get an error, and you definitely get an error on your shiny app, you will not be sure where exactly that error comes from, because it's not modularized, and that error can come from name conflicts with previous variables, interaction or reactive values that are too difficult to grasp. But if you work with modules, you're only working on one module, so if you're app breaks, you kind of know that it's related to something that you are working on in that particular moment, in that particular module. So complex only with shiny modules. I have tried it, and in theoretically, of course, you can do it without modules, but it will get a nightmare at some point, and you will have to rewrite it with modules if you really have to want to manage it right. But even with shiny modules, I have developed I have discovered that at the moment of deployment, the app didn't work. Also, it worked on my machine. And at that point, it was really, really difficult. From what I have found, I wasn't using modules very well. Modules were not loading as I thought that should be loaded. This was my experience. First, I started with a complex with an app. It grew bigger. Then I went to Shiny modules, and then entered Golem. Entered Golem to rescue, because Golem is really a production framework. It's a production framework, and the main advantages of Golem, it's easy deployment, no errors. So with Golem, no matter how complex it is, the only error you may get, or I got, given that I was working on an internal server, or just installing libraries that I needed, and that's it. And maybe some writes on folders for users. But other than that, it really went straightforward. So this is actually the main advantages. When you deploy, it's really almost without errors. Of course, it is overwhelming at first. As a disadvantage of Golem, it is overwhelming. It's not, first of all, because it's not something that you are used to. You are used to even working with maybe one file. I mean, not even UI and server file. And you have to manage a lot of files. Well, not so many, but you kind of have to know about four or five files and their location in your project and what it is that they do. And another small disadvantage that I would say, but you will encounter it, is you have to adapt your coding style. And that is, you won't have to, you cannot write group by. You have to go by dplyr group by. And that is just to enforce namespacing and all the libraries being there, and not all the libraries being exactly in your project and not just loaded. And then when you deploy it, the libraries aren't there. And of course, you will get a lot of errors at the beginning with that. You will definitely forget to use dplyr select, for instance. You'll use select just because you're used to it. But you have to get used to that. But after that, all your scripts, you write dplyr select. You don't use libraries. You won't load libraries anymore. But the advantages, I go back, you will get a much better understanding of shaRing modules. You can call modules from within modules. You can control when your modules are being called. You can control your UIs better. And it's really, really, I mean, it takes some time to understand it, but at the end, it's really, really rewarding, because you actually get a profound understanding of shaRing. And another advantage that I have found is that you can reuse models for other applications. And that means that your model, it acts almost like a library. For instance, I always had to read Excel files within my apps, right? So in an app, I had to read like two or three Excel files provided by, there was a different output. And I have discovered that, of course, if you have to read two or three Excel files, maybe a module, which acts like a function, right, can do a better job. So from within a module, I call the module that actually reads my Excel. And when I say that, I mean, it reads, it asks the user what kind of sheet it should read, because it detects more sheets. And then it searches within the Excel where exactly are located your column names that you provided, that they should be there. Of course, it depends on your need. But in this way, it acts almost like a library. And I have to say, in the last conversation on Shiny Developer Series on YouTube channel. The last guest, I can't remember her name, presented exactly that. She developed a module where you would edit a data table. So in a data table, she had some buttons over on top, and those buttons were exactly editing a data table, much nicer for the user. And of course, you can check your app. You have some functions that tools check, and it will show you exactly what is wrong with your app, or warnings or errors. But anyway, I found, and not only me, but in the actually in the community, global community, Golem framework really has had gained a lot of attraction, and people are really using. I've put a link here to my GitHub. My GitHub is empty, unfortunately. I had gained rights to GitHub recently for my work, so I just started using it, and I will use it more often. But this is a skeleton Shiny dashboard app. I'm mostly using Shiny dashboard. You also have a login modules. Users are just stored in a file, not a database, but with passwords hashed. And over there you can just open up a project like we did last time. Last time here, open a project, the dev in R, and enter this link and get a skeleton shiny dashboard app developed with Golem.
Wow.
And I think cool. That's it. Yes.
Thank you. So this is quite interesting. I mean, I heard about Golem, mm-hmm. but never actually deep dived. So so practically these modules are like functions, actually. I mean, just for me to better...
They can act like functions, but not necessarily. In these modules, you actually develop your whole application. Uh-huh. A module has two parts, a UI function and a server function, mm-hmm. right? And yeah. the Golem project, so from our studio, it's new project and Golem project, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Golem project comes with predefined files, and over there you have an app UI file and an app server file. So in an app UI file, you tell him, get me the UI from this module. In a server file, you tell him, get me the UI, call me the server from this module. And UI is usually called within a Shiny dashboard page function, and then the app that I have provided you, it's you have the menu on the left, and once you click the menu on the left, it shows you the UI that associated with that
So it's can you put the link in the chat so everyone can
yes of course it's way easier. Yeah.
Other questions? Întrebări? Am primit un feedback. We received a feedback to invite you for a more longer presentation. So.
Okay. Just a minute.
So this is quite live. So think about it.
I will think about it. Of course, I'm open to it. I'm just waiting for the Colin Fay and the ThinkR team to actually finish their book. I just want to make sure that whatever it is that I'm presenting you is by the standards, because by the standards imposed by their creators. Because I have found that you won't find the support within the community that you get for Shiny. So for Golem, if you want to, ask a question, it will be a little bit more difficult to actually get an answer, mostly specific to Golem. Of course, to Shiny modules, there's a lot of literature, but with Golem, there's really. And I know they're writing a book. The book is over there, but it has a lot of chapters that have not been finished. So I'm waiting. I think they will publish it on Amazon.
Oh, okay. So we'll.
We'll
follow them. Of course.
You probably need a workshop just to get you started, if you encounter problems, just know where the problem is. But you can reach me, of course, with any problems that you may get trying to delve into the thing.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Questions? Still questions? No questions? Okay, so we should go on the agenda, with the agenda ahead. So it's Simona, is it okay to continue?
Yeah, sure.
Let me give you the co-host.
Great, I don't have a presentation as my previous speaker had, but I can talk free about what I did this year. So I can also share if needed, because I have some R code and some structure in place. But here's what I did so far. So 2020 was an interesting year for me. I've discovered a lot of things in R. Basically, I automated a lot of my things, especially whatever processing I was doing in Excel and formatting in Excel with openxlsx, which was a really interesting one, because I basically reduced my time spent formatting deliverables like 90%. I just cut that time by 90%. I'm just running a few models, exporting some outputs, and I have some functions that are basically openxlsx. And what they do is that in the end, everything is colored, everything is bold, everything is conditional formatting, everything you need is in there. Maybe at the end, I'll just, add an extra border or stuff like that, things that only take you like less than a second or so. So that's a really interesting one. I mean, especially for projects that were very demanding, and whenever you have tons of deliverables to prepare in terms of Excel outputs, because yes, this is the truth. Everyone in business is basically used to working in Excel. So everyone wants some numbers in Excel. That was a major discovery for me, and it was really helpful for both me and my team. And something else that I've been doing in the last quarter or so, let's say. Many thanks to Ines for launching this challenge to me. I started blogging with R. That's something that I always wanted to do so, but I just never found the idea that I wanted to write about. But like in the last 2 years, I have basically improved my skills, built and improved my skills in Markdown. And when that blogging part came with blogdown, it was a perfect match. I mean, blogdown basically creates the structure of Markdown. So I can show you what I have. I think that could be really helpful for you. And also, in addition, I must definitely add this to whatever I'm presenting right now. I'm a teaching assistant at the Bucharest University of Economic Studies. And also, I've been doing a lot of things in R. So all my all my documentations are in R, something like this. And this
very
is
nice. Shared with very the nice.
Yeah, yeah, and it's really reproductible, and I really loved it. I mean, it's much useful than, you know, whenever you're writing an equation in Excel in Word, it's basically you have to center this one, you have to add a lot of things by pen, then it's really, really a mess, especially when you want to do it something like from a week to another. And it's really nice. I just loved it. I mean, it was really nice to share with my teacher and students, and it was amazing. And I also have an official profile here, which is my official resume, which I've also built in Markdown, which looks like this, in case you were wondering. And it's really, really nice. I mean, whenever you have something like this, you can see that those are basically hyperlinks, and they go to whatever I have in here. I think there's something that I've been putting down here. I'm also passionate about football, so there you go. Oh, there isn't. I forgot to update it. Anyway, I wanted to talk about my blog, and I spent some other time on other things. So here's what I have. So the structure is basically in Blogdown and Hugo. It's everything based in R. I'm just committing all my changes to GitHub, and GitHub connects automatically to Netlify, and then everything is published. So here's what I did for my November post, for instance. This is how it looks like. I have a title. I've been putting some text in here, and then I have a lot of lines of code for the ggplot that I'm taking and preparing, and preparing the data. And let me show you how it looks like. So this is the blog. It's a really nice template. It took a while to find it, but I really like it. And here's my last post. And it's really clean, it's really reproductible, and I just love the ggplot, I must say. I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing to plot everything from a line of code, and then have everything in place, everything reproducible, just tweak a little thing, and then everything will be automatically changed without, I mean, I've had a lot of experience with Excel and with PowerPoint, I think as everyone had, and it's a mess. If you want to update something, it's really a mess. I mean, you have to change everything by hand, or you use some sort of virtual basic sort of thing or coding behind, so that you won't have that mess around whenever you're updating something. And ggplot is amazing for me. I want to transit towards making the presentations at work in R as well, such as we can use the all of those. So yeah, here's what I've been doing. A lot of people lie in online dating, but yeah, that was a topic for November. I'm planning to write something on the Christmas, I don't know, dating during Christmas. If you have any ideas, feel free to reach me. But yeah, I just loved it. Of course, it was a bit tricky to put everything in place. I've had a lot of issues. I think I've had a lot of issues with the theme that I've been choosing, basically, because Ines did the same, and for her it was really straightforward, and for me it took like a week to figure it out. But eventually everything worked, and I am currently an active blogger, and I really like it. I mean, everything that's R-related, it's really groundbreaking for me, and I'm sure I'll be doing that for quite a while. Yep, I think that was on my side. I hope it was fast.
Yeah, don't worry. It was okay. Yeah. Thank you. I wanted to say that it's because I use the common theme. This is why it took me less. But if you choose a theme, for example, I tried 2 weeks ago. I found a theme similar to Medium, and I wanted to test it. and I couldn't. I had to delete everything. So it depends if it's a common one, then yes, use it. But if it's one that's not so common, it can be more difficult, let's say. It's not impossible, but I wouldn't recommend it because you'll lose a lot of time. And yeah, but what Simona did, I think it's quite amazing in terms of looks and styling and topic, of course. By the way, there is a series on Netflix regarding Christmas. Maybe it can inspire you. I'll check it out. And
that's great. Nice suggestion. Thank you.
Yeah,
Christmas is coming, so I don't have enough time to write about it. I think it's in 10 days.
You need to.
Yeah, I need to hurry up with whatever I'm posting this month, but I'll see. I have found some data. I already looked into a lot of data for the last two posts or so, and I'm also planning to write something about how dating evolves during the pandemics. But I thought Christmas is more catchy for this time of year, and maybe I'll postpone that pandemic till January or so, but we will see.
Well, thanks a lot, Simona. And I hope I'll see you in February.
Definitely. We have something in place with baking the subject.
Yes, yes. Okay, so let's move forward. Who's there? Maria. Let's see. Maria, can you hear us? Maria? Maybe she has some issues. What we could do if cannot hear her. Let's go further a bit. Gabriel, is it okay for you to continue? And then we'll get back to Maria.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. So first, thank you for the music, Gabriel. It was, as always, wonderful. Wonderful music. And
I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, it's, you know, in this context with the pandemic, I think the good vibes are the one that actually set up going forward. So yes.
Yeah, I think so. And maybe we're going to have like an in-person festival in maybe 6 months. Hopefully.
Yeah, let's hope for something like that. Yeah, to go back to V7 startup studio.
Yeah. Really nice place.
Yeah. Some wine and good vibes. Okay, so you had some graph for us that you prepared. So let's see.
Okay, I think I can. Oh, just a second. Can you see it?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, I wanted to prepare a graph for this meeting, precisely a ridge plot that is going to be applied on daily currency data. Well, let's say, for example, that we want to describe the movements of the exchange rate in a better manner so that we can get more information from the plot, more information that you get, for example, from your line plot, let's say. I'm going to dive directly into the coding part because I think I forgot to set my timer. I usually do this in meetings. I don't know if you guys are doing this, but
yes, don't worry. I will give you some updates when you have.
Okay, that's great. That's
1 minute before.
That's great. It's great to have that.
1 minute and the 5 minute for questions. Yeah, somewhere around.
That's middle. That's great to have a colleague for that. Very, very helpful. Okay, so we want to look at the exchange rate, and what better exchange rate than our own exchange rate with the only currency that we are officially trading. In case you didn't know, we are not directly trading with the US dollar or other currency. It's doing by cross. Okay, so moving on. The data comes from the National Bank of Romania, and we have two XLS files. You're going to see in a while why we have two files. We're going to load the necessary libraries, and what we have here, we have data for RON and for ROL. Yeah, what is the difference between them? ROL was our initial currency, the Romanian leu. But in 2005, we had to go through the redenomination process. This is the official term, redenomination. If we put it in layman's term, we from the back of the number, four zeros just puff away, and we have the new Romanian leu. So we have to take this into account when we're building our database. Okay, bind the two databases together, extract our year. We're going to use it for our ridge plot, and look at the exchange rate in a very simple line plot. What can we see? Can you see my pointer?
Yes, we can see it.
Yeah, great. So you see that we have a rapid increase from the early 2000s. Yeah, we had a period of appreciation pre-crisis, and then the exchange rate was increasing again. Well, this is the most we can get from this graph. We only have the movement. Let's say we want to have a more statistical view. For example, we want to see how the distribution is moving in time. And for me, the best answer was to build a ridge plot. And okay, let's go to our data visualization. Okay, what can we see here? We have the distribution of the exchange rate in every year. Each line here represents an year. We can see, for example, that it is moving towards the right when it's depreciating, and the period of appreciation, and then it depreciated again. This is the first observation. Another observation, is that starting from 2013, I guess, or 12, okay, something in that range, it began to be more normally, not in a statistical sense, in a visual sense. What does it mean? It means that the entire spectrum of the values were concentrated towards the medium value, the average, which means that it didn't have large variations. And from a modeling point of view, it is more predictable. For example, you can use simply the mean, and you're going to have a perfect prediction. And actually, I think it's very nice to see, for example, that at the beginning of our currency, it had like a very strange distribution, like a lot of hikes and other stuff like that. But now it looks very, very decent. Yeah, so I guess this is the main things. Okay, save by the bell. We can stop.
Oh, sorry. Here. So, in fact,
I've never used the ridge plot before. I've never seen one, which is really interesting. I mean, do you typically use it for describing the data by year or by period or so? Or can you also figure out another way of filtering? Does it matter? Mm. Or just looking at the variable distribution across whatever you want to, and you just picked the time period there.
I think you can also put here, like, for example, cycles of production or processes or whatever you can put there, just to, I mean, just to have some, let's say, some logic of movement, because if they are fairly distributed over time or over processes, you're going to get that all are centered around this value, and really don't see any. I think the original example of this graph was on temperature, mm-hmm. I think.
Yeah, and I think it's helpful to see if it's how it actually evolves. I mean, for me, this graph, it seems somehow that at some point we started to have a more predictable exchange rate.
From one perspective, it also means that you didn't encounter any large variations, and you can say that this is good, but at the same time, from a policy perspective, it's not that good, because if you're trying to plot the same graph for example, Hungary, Poland, or the Czech Republic, or Czechia, sorry, you're going to see that they have larger extreme values.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So yes, I'm not an expert. I mean, in this area, it's not quite my. I was just thinking in terms of the graph. So yeah. Probably in a more contextual analysis, then you can conclude something else. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Other questions? Specific questions? Okay.
Do you find it difficult to read?
No. I mean from my point of view.
No, it's a bit wonderful. And I also like the color gradient that you put in there. But my judgment was whether I can use that for something else. So, for instance, instead of plotting the year there on the y-axis, maybe I can have like a categorical variable, such as...
You can have one. And actually, you can see better if, for example, one category can be used to predict another category, or if their distributions are similar or very, very different. So...
Yeah, precisely. That I was looking for a solution to come up with solving that one, because I'm looking at some segments of people and I want to see if there are some significant differences in between the segments, especially when looking at a specific variable. I don't know. And that one, it's pure gold. So thank you.
Okay, I'm gonna charge you for that.
Nope.
just joking. I think we're going to distribute this material, and you're going to have the code there. So, yeah, no problem.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Gabriel.
Thank you.
So Maria is she's having some issues, so she'll try to come back at somewhere at the end. Okay, so I'll continue with my presentation. I have some simple stuff. So I discovered, I think, last meetup, xaringan package. And I thought it's an interesting topic to have for tonight, because it took me some time to start using it. One second, just to activate my timer. So xaringan presentation, this is a xaringan presentation, what you are seeing, and the template, the way it looks and the way it it's styled, it's a kunoki theme. What I really liked about this package was firstly that this presentation is online. So for example, if you want to review it together with me, I can send you in chat the link. One second, everyone. Okay, so you can review it together with me. So this is one thing that that I like. Then, as I said, the styling. So you have easy and reproductible way to reproduce styling and colors. And this is made using this package named xaringan. Of course, xaringan, it's a package dedicated for creating slideshows. And this package was, of course, named after a character from Naruto's, which has a combination of abilities, an eye for insights and an eye for hypnotism. So I would say that this is quite a very good promotional way of presenting xaringan, because actually it helps you a lot to present your stuff. I think Simona said earlier that she is thinking about moving from PowerPoint, from presentation. And of course, if you don't use any, you know, reporting tools, I'm not going to name it, then xaringan is definitely a very good choice to tackle. If you want to start over, I clearly recommend the tutorial, the package tutorial. I put it here the link, and of course the author website, as Marius suggesting earlier, of reviewing the official package tutorial or book. This is similar. I recommend to go straight to the source, and of course to improve it. How you start to create such a presentation? Of course, you need to install xaringan. You need to create an R markdown file, which you use from the template. You select a ninja presentation. And then in terms of generating such presentation as I'm showing you, then you need to use the knit button. This is one way. And then another way, if you are using RStudio, you have an add-in and you can review it in real time, the presentation. Either way you are choosing, you will still get this nice dynamic presentation. I think Marius also used a similar presentation. So yes. I highly recommend such options. Now regarding themes, I chose this theme, but you can use another one. There are two ways to discover. Either you go directly to the source on the package website and you review them, or you can discover them from the console. You use the names and list the CSS function. And for me, I used, as I said at the beginning, this kunoichi theme. It's a theme developed by Emi Tanakas. And this is specifically for the R ladies, because it has the styling, the colors, and it's easily to be used. I just complete in the output, in the YAML section, the styling, the needed styling, which is the kunoichi and nijutsu one. So I would say it's quite straightforward. And now going further with the things I like, because I think I have some few seconds. So I like, as I said, the way that you can reproduce stuff. So it's easy to be reproductible. It can be easily customized and you can add easily dynamic things. I really enjoy the fact that you can put such counters, yes, like the countdown and the autoplay way. It depends the way you want to see the time. So this is quite helpful when you keep a very important presentation with a longer spectrum, then it's useful. And then I was saying about the part regarding dynamics and like GIFs, tweets, YouTube, so you can easily include them. Of course, you can include graph, you can include leaflet maps, so all these kind of things. What I have discovered, and I want you to know, I discovered, for example, xaringan Extra. This is an add-on package which helps you actually to embed this kind of presentation in a site. And then you can add the options for social sharing the presentation. So this is quite useful. So for example, if you are in a hurry and you want to create a presentation, for example, you are in a hackathon and you want to present your ideas, xaringan is a very good idea. And then you can just publish it on a website and add such an option of sharing it. So could be an idea. And the customization part. So I've seen recently, I've participated in a webinar in which a lady presented us the way she created some customization, some CSS file dedicated to her company. So you can actually have presentations such as you receive those styles, the master slides of PowerPoint at corporate level. This can be replicated similar in R using this package and this option. So these are, I think I was fast questions. I can also show you if you want to see, it's quite fast, if you want.
Pare că am rămas doar noi,
deci putem
trece
pe română. Putem să trecem pe română?
Da.
Da.
E ok. Cool. So, da, asta era, asta e ultima mea descoperire, partea de xaringan. Ce m-a surprins e exact partea asta, că pot să customizez foarte mult. Eu am văzut în partea de comunitatea asta NHS, care este foarte puternică în zona de AR, acolo am văzut prezentările astea de care vorbesc, adică ele erau customizate pentru NHS, cu culorile de branding, cu regulile lor, foarte foarte mișto mi s-a părut. Exact așa cum primești la job sau în fine, cel puțin în mediul ăsta corporate, noi primim template-ul de branding, știi, în care ai master slide-ul de PowerPoint și tu doar îți alegi slide-ul de prezentare și se aplică acolo culori, bolduire, cum trebuie, and so on. Da.
Cred că o chestie de genul ăsta aveau cei de la parcă BBC erau? Da, parcă cei de la BBC.
Da.
Și, îi știi, nu? Aveau și cookbook.
Da, Au Gigi BBC Plot, actually, the package.
Așa, au făcut pachet, corect.
Da. Practic, asta e varianta cea mai bună, să-ți faci un pachet. Dacă o să căutați, RBNB-ul are o soluție de asta. Ei când au început cu R, acum s-au dus în alte direcții. Dar acum câțiva ani, RBNB-ul și-a construit echipă de data science, au avut un program destul de amplu de educare a angajaților și practic ce au făcut, au încercat să meargă pe zona asta de reproducere ușoară. Și una din variante a fost asta, să construiască pachete și practic tu om mai puțin de data, că nu toată lumea e ca noi pasionată de AR și de coding și na, unii vor doar niște rapoarte în Excel, cum povesteau și ante înaintea mea. Și atunci tu poți să-i construiești o funcție și să-i zici raport, știi, ca la API-uri.
Da.
Raport de pe X până pe X. Și atunci e it work. It can work. Nu știu. Sunt mai multe variante, în fine. Asta e o variantă mai veche, mai sunt și altele. Dar, da, cei de la BBC oricum sunt foarte, sunt ahead.
Da, jurnaliștii britanici, într-adevăr, sunt, cam știu să programeze, într-adevăr, asta nu curvă și eu. Și le este ceva deosebit. Și ce vreau să te întreb, să alintă next? Stai.
Făcusem o glumă și merg mână în bună, știi, jurnaliștii britanici cu cercetătorii britanici,
da,
unii
da.
Pe ceilalți.
Da. Sarin de Nextra, ce zici că face doar pentru deployment pe site-uri sau pentru altceva?
Practic, funcția pentru care am găsit eu practic pachetul, te ajută să faci sharing la prezentare. Și să-ți apară opțiunile alea de social media, gen share to Facebook, share to nu știu ce. Cred că e și către are câteva opțiuni foarte ok pe zona asta de publishing, știi? Și, nu știu, de exemplu, dacă te duci la un hackathon, mi se pare opțiune bună, știi, să mânuiești xaringan, îl pui pe un site și gata, te-ai...
Bine, el și simplu, așa, trimiți un fișier HTML, un fișier HTML până la urmă chiar că poate să vadă oricine, adică... Este...
Da, bine, da, așa e, așa. Așa, na, mai poți să folosești și Flex Dashboard dacă folosești de HTML, dar în zona asta de prezentare, xaringan e clar, mi s-a părut ok. Frumușel și ușor, adică se învață ușor. Eu l-am folosit acum o lună, când am avut-o pe Free și pe Ana și... A fost quite straightforward. Recunosc, mi-a fost mai dificil să învăț să-l public. Deci asta am reușit pentru întâlnirea de azi.
Da.
Știi că nu...
Prima oară l-am folosit, dar am rulat un fișier, un HTML pe care îl generez în project. L-am rulat, l-am deschis cu Chrome-ul. Și de asta mi s-a părut foarte ok. Pentru că, ok, trimit o prezentare pe mail, să zicem, da, ok, cu HTML, poate să-l deschidă chiar oricine, nu e niciun fel de problemă. Și nu m-am dus mai departe și tu să intre în extra, că, na, mă rog, era chiar nevoie. Și am văzut că există un team, eu am folosit team-ul Our Ladies.
Da. Asta e primul.
Da. Și păreau similare, adică cred că era aceeași culoare, mov-ul acela.
Da.
Este într-adevăr, e foarte ușor de folosit. E aproape că nu te blochezi de loc.
Exact, adică...
Pentru ceva nou de învățat este...
Da, și ce am mai observat, eu nu știu dacă vi s-a întâmplat, cel puțin în mediul ăsta unde mă mișc pe corporate, contează foarte mult să faci chestii flashy și rapid, știi? Și una din variantele flashy și rapid, tot așa descoperită recent, a fost asta că... Adică eu folosesc ggplot, foarte puțin ce-i drept, dar nu m-am gândit niciodată că cum poți să-l dinamizezi. De fapt, asta era una din întrebările mele. Băi, dar cum îl faci? Că nu poți să faci doar plotly, că oamenii ăștia zic, știi, și ai funcția aia, ggplotly și de graf, știi? Și pentru mine, iară, this is another tips and tricks, că te ajută foarte mult să-ți simplifici și să show off că...
Da, exact, cu asta chiar că
pentru asta
faci rapid, da. Mai ales dacă ți-ai știi ce teme, ce fonturi, ce...
Exact, îți creezi niște styluri, o rogăm pe Simo, că am văzut că are un ochi super bun de culori. Dacă nu e disponibil, am găsit niște site-uri, vă trimit, ca să ne orientăm pe culori și...
Recunosc că la culori cel mai mult folosesc, nu știu dacă știți, e un pachet Viridis. Sunt cele mai frumoase culori, în cele mai frumoase combinații.
Aprob.
Exact. Parcă nimic. De fiecare dată tot timpul spun că o să-mi creez o paletă de culori, dar nimic din ce fac nu se compară cu Viridis. Aha. Gen nimic. M-am lovit de multe ori de chestia asta. Așa că, da, Viridis all the way.
Așa. Bine, hai să vedem dacă Maria, ne auzi?
Auzi, mai
auzi? Da, auzim.
Auzim.
Toate bune?
Da.
Hai să văd.
Imediat. Nu știu cum o fac share aici.
Nu ți-am dat co-host? Ba da, ți-am dat co-host. Te duce un buton verde când te duce pe ecran și da. E după ce folosești atât Teams.
Eu astăzi voi face așa o mică introducere în cum să automatizați procesele de lucru atunci când folosiți Google Sheets. Și am pregătit un mic script în R unde voi explica câte funcții care mi-au fost utile mie. Mai întâi aș prezenta puțin setul de date. Am folosit un set de date pe care noi în principal l-avem la comun la master și facem diferite analize pe el și vizualizări. În primul sheet avem comenzile, în al doilea are tururile, în al treilea regiunile, noi le foloseam ca să putem să facem vizualizările și aici, în sumar, vom aduce noi o tabelă pe care o vom crea în R. Google Sheet for oferă o interfață R către Google Sheet prin intermediul IP-ului. Pentru a putea face această legătură, avem nevoie de o configurare pe care o vom realiza cu, în principal, cu această funcție. Mai sunt și alte opțiuni, dar eu pe aceasta am folosit-o. Apoi, prima funcție pe care am folosit-o și am prezentat-o și aici a fost să citesc un fișier din Google Sheets. Și aici l-am citit folosind pur și simplu link-ul. Și am pus aici link-ul și l-am accesat. Și mi-am adus tabela în app. Are mai multe coloane. Are 1952 de observații și 22 de coloane. Mai departe, cu ajutorul librăriei de data asta a Google Drive, ne-am adus un alt sheet, acesta, retururi. Dar de data aceasta, utilizând numele fișierului și numele sheet-ului. Și pentru a accesa pagina, drive-yet mă ajută să identific fișierul prin ID-ul fișierului drive-ului. La asta ajută funcția get drive-yet. Apoi, read sheet mă ajută să citesc sheet-ul. Și am apelat această sintaxă și mi-am adus și celălalt sheet sub forma unei tabele. Și am denumit retururi, după cum era și numele sheet-ului. Puteam să-i pun orice altă denumire. Mai departe, din tabela comenzi, am creat un sumar pe care o să le export într-o foaie pe care am creat-o deja, în foaia sumar, în care acum nu am nimic, este goală. Îmi spune că mi-a spus sumar. Și acum vedem că s-a populat acest sheet. Și mi-a făcut, eu făcusem un sumar pe nivelul de prioritate comandă și pe segmentul de clienți, dacă este corporate, PSA, persoană fizică. E o tabelă de vânzări produse și și spune și cu ce le transportă. Și în ultima parte, din AR am creat un un nou, cum îi spune, un proiect.
Fișier.
Da, un nou fișier. L-am lăsat. Apoi, în My Data Frame, ne-am adus două tabele care mi le-am creat eu, retururi și sumar comenzi. Și cu ajutorul acestei funcții, mi-am creat fișierul demo în care o să-mi duc aceste două tabele. Și acum o să vă arăt că o să... Imediat.
Să știi că nu mai vedem. Sau...
Imediat.
Și practic ți s-a creat fișierul în Google Sheets, nu? Asta vrei să ne arăți acum.
Da. Deci eu am zis să mi-o denumească demo și prima foaie să o denumească foaie 1, iar a doua foaie 2. În foaie 1 să pună retururile, iar în a doua sumarul pe care l-am creat mai târziu. Și aici mi l-a denumit demo. M-a mai auzit?
Da, te auzim.
Așa, mi-a pus numele foilor și rezultatele.
Uh-huh.
Aici am zis să-mi pună doar capul de tabel, dacă nu mă știu, da, am zis să-mi pună doar capul de tabel.
Da, head-ul. Da. Uh-huh.
Da. Cam atât de la mine.
Da.
La fix te-ai încadrat.
E super drăguț pentru cine chiar lucrează cu Google Sheets și Google Drive. Recunosc că nu prea am date pe acolo și că mai toate le-am local sau nu am Drive, dar mie personal mi s-ar părea util. Adică dacă chiar ar fi să interacționez cu asta, probabil m-aș folosi și de pachetele astea. Drăguță introducere, mulțumim!
Cu plăcere! Ajută mulțumim. Mai ales când lucrez în echipă și ești la facultate.
Mhm.
Faci un share la folder și după aia la accesezi din ar.
Super.
Da. Și Google Sheets for e făcut și de o tipă, adică maintainerul sau tipa care are pachetul, e o tip oricum.
E Jenny Bryan, nu?
Exact.
Bryan este, este tot.
Ca și Julia.
Ca și Julia, da. Chiar mai mult și decât Julia, dacă se poate spune.
Da.
Google Sheets e foarte, foarte bine integrat cu AR-ul și știu că merge super, cum ne arăta și Maria, adică este totul imediat. Eu voiam să vă rog dacă mai folosiți și alte API-uri de la Google. Eu am folosit Google Vision și din Shiny nu prea am reușit, ca să fiu sincer. Din script am reușit. Din Shiny n-am reușit ca să-l fac să, adică să fie autentificarea în spate, folosind contul meu, doar așa solicitând în datele mele de cont. Ca idee, ca să vă faceți ce înseamnă Google Vision API, te costă $1.50 1000 de pagini.
Să-ți citească.
OCR. Și... mă rog, n-am ajuns la nivelul atât de avansat să compar cu ABI, care să zicem că ar fi state of the art sau aproape state of the art. Eu cred că și-am făcut propriul tool, dar prețul este foarte, foarte redus. Adică dacă vreți să automatizați, sunt corporațiile, cum zic, automatizări, folosesc, zic, OCR, efectivul cu OCR. În Google Vision este super straightforward. Dar nu am mers atât pentru că nu am făcut genii așa ceva.
doar, cum îl cheamă, Edmond sau nu știu.
Mark Edmondson.
Așa, Mark Edmondson, mersi.
Dar el nu...
El, că a mai dezvoltat.
Da. O să închid un pic înregistrarea.
Ok.
Așa, ca